Smooth 98.1, love music, love life. You're welcome to the Smooth Health on the Drive inside of Smooth Drive. My name is Judith TV.
I'm Patty Baker, and today we have a very special guest in the studio. Today we're going to be talking about something called laparoscopic surgeries, managing gallstone diseases, and minimal invasive surgery.
With minimal invasive surgery.
Yes, of course.
Smooth Health on the Drive is sponsored by Evercare Hospital Lekki, and we have with us a very special guest. We have Dr. Arinze Mosanya.
He is a consultant general and minimal access surgeon with extensive competencies in surgical oncology, especially of the breast and colorectal. Also, he's well experienced with surgical gastroenterology and endoscopy, amongst other things. Hello, sir. Good to have you here.
Thank you, Tunde. Thank you, Judith. I'm glad to be here.
It's Kayode.
All right. Great. Go on. Sorry. If you're out there and you want to be a part of our conversation, please reach out to us on our WhatsApp platform or call the studio lines. Call 01-44-89-981 or send WhatsApp messages to 0809-444-0981. By the way, Evercare is giving out free vouchers to of course, the first three callers that call in and contribute to the conversation today. So once again, 0809-444-0981. That's where you can, you know,
send your WhatsApp messages to, but you can also call us up on 01-448-9981. Again, 01-448-9981. That's our telephone line to contact us here with you in the studio with any questions that you have for Dr. Arinze Chuku. So doctor, let's get started. What are gallstone diseases and some of its risk factors?
Thank you. Gallstone diseases are diseases that arise from the formation of stones, otherwise called calculi, in the gallbladder. The gallbladder is a small sac, relatively small sac, that's found under the liver on the right side, and its function is to concentrate bile. And bile is a substance produced by the liver that helps us to digest food when we eat food, especially fatty food. So in this bile are contained things like cholesterol, bilirubin, water, and some other chemicals and salts that help to keep food in a very liquid form and help the digestion process. So gallstones arise if there's an imbalance between the amount of cholesterol and bilirubin in this bile, and this can be caused by a lot of other factors. So with respect to risk factors, these risk factors could be the ones we call non-modifiable risk factors, which we don't have any powers to change.
Okay.
And then some modifiable risk factors, as well as certain disease conditions that can predispose an individual to having gallstones. So coming to the non-modifiable risk factors, so things like female gender, the race which we come from is commoner in the whites
and
Mexican.
I've heard that before, the race where we come from. Why does that play a major role?
Well, some of these things are respect to genetic makeup.
Okay.
We know that blacks have a different genetic makeup to the Caucasians, the Mexican Americans, the Latinos, and all that.
So Asian.
So also diet may be contributory, but that will fall under modifiable risk factors. So females have more risk to developing gallstone disease than males. And then increasing age, I mean, the older you get, the more risk of developing gallstones that you have. And and for the modifiable risk factors, so people that have high blood cholesterol, those who eat a lot of fatty food or food that are very low in fiber also have increased risk of having gallstones. And then for disease conditions, so certain diseases like diabetes mellitus, sickle cell disease patients tend to have a lot of gallstones because they are rapidly breaking down their red cells, and these red cells, when it's broken down, yields a substance called bilirubin, and when this gets to the gallbladder, it can precipitate as what we call the pigment stones in the gallbladder, and on a long-standing basis, this can now lead to other further complications. And then for pregnant women also, they have increased risk of having gallstones, as well as those who take certain medications like estrogen-containing contraceptive pills also have increased risk of having gallstones. Majority of gallstones are actually asymptomatic, meaning patients don't have symptoms and may be identified when they go for other tests or checks, like maybe somebody goes for a wellness checkup and say, we found something in your gallbladder, and I've never had any pain. Yeah, it can happen.
Okay.
But a good number of patients may come down what we call symptomatic gallstone disease. That's when they start having certain signs and symptoms that will point to the fact that you have a gallstone. So chief of this is pain on the upper right side of the abdomen. And this pain, patients describe it as coming up after eating food or eating fatty meals. And if you go back to the function of the gallbladder, when you eat a fatty meal, the gallbladder will contract to push bowel to help you to digest that fatty meal. So that process, they will have pain.
Let's phone lines are buzzing. Let's see who this person is. I think I've got questions. Hello. Good evening.
Good evening. Your name and where you're calling us from? Timmy Dio from Ekosi. Timmy Dio, you are your first caller and our first winner today. You've won yourself a 10,000 naira voucher courtesy Evercare Hospital. All right, go ahead with your question. Oh, look at that.
First time winner.
Oh, nice. Well, you are in luck today. Congratulations. So go ahead with your question, please.
I'm more likely to have it. Just every day of my life, any decision I'm making, anything I'm doing, I'm always thinking about those ladies. So, what are the likely symptoms, or how can one check to be sure that there is nothing like this infection or this condition, health conditions for a lady? Is there a possible test that can be conducted, or is there a symptom, or is there anything one can check or notice that can quickly alert you that, hey, this is wrong, this is what is happening, quickly go for treatment? And is there a cure? Okay, I think you mentioned that there are some modified cases and some unmodified. So I just really want to know, what are the symptoms, what are the signs, how can one, is there a test that can show that one is suffering from this disease or this infection?
All right, thank you so much, Timitayo, for your call there. We have another caller here. See who this is. Hello.
Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening, sir. Your name, where you're calling us from, please?
My name is Nuruddin Goriola. I'm calling from Bikopi, Ogun State, under Sagamu local government.
Wow, you're calling from Sagamu. It's good to hear from you, Nuruddin. Good afternoon to you. So you won yourself a voucher. What 10,000 naira from Lekki, from the Evercare Hospital Lekki here in Lagos. But it goes to your first consultancy fee at Lekki, at the hospital Lekki. Would you want that ticket, that voucher? Should we reserve that for you?
I want the airtime.
Okay, you want it, right? Absolutely. So we're going to keep it for you. So congratulations, you're our second winner. Please go ahead with your question.
Thank you so much. Yes, I listened clearly to the interview you got, the doctor in the house there.
Yes.
Yes. My wife is she's having a pain under the breast. So I want to ask the doctor, is it cancer or what? Let me give him time to explain briefly. And what are the symptoms to cancer? And what is the way out? If it is cancer, what can we do to prevent?
All right, thank you so much for Nuruddin for your call there. Let's see who the next caller is. Hello? Oh, we lost you there. Hello?
Hello, good evening.
Yeah, hello, good evening.
Good evening.
Richmond calling from Maryland.
Your name is?
Richmond calling from Maryland.
Richmond. Hi, Richmond, how are you doing today?
Richmond, you are third and final winner for today, so congratulations. Richmond, go ahead with your question.
Thank you very much. Yeah, I have someone, like a very close friend of mine, who is having the pain under the private part. I don't know. And I want to confirm, is there any cure for it? And does it come with age? Like, the sickness, does it come with age? Is it...
We lost you there,
but we got the gist of your question. He's asking... pain under the private parts, does it come with age?
Okay, thank you, Richmond.
And also to Nuruddin and Timidayo as well. Timidayo.
Thanks for your questions, and I'll take them one after the other. For Richmond, pain under the private parts could connote a lot of other pathologies, and it will be inappropriate now to tell you what particular may be causing this pain. So I would suggest that this patient could reach out to us at the hospital, book an appointment to see, well, if he's a male, we'll probably see the urologist.
Mm.
And if he's a female, she'll see the gynecologist and have him checked out. No one should have pain on a private part. Yeah. Maybe a pointer to a disease or a condition, but the earlier it's checked out, the faster he can get solutions.
To Nuruddin,
yes.
Question of pain under the breast.
I would have loved to find out what kind of pain this is and if there is a lump or any other conditions, symptoms that this patient may be having. So I would advise Nuruddin to take advantage of the voucher that has been offered to him and come down to the hospital to have him evaluated by a specialist breast physician. And if it's not a breast condition, it may be something in the chest because of the relationship of the breast to the chest. So any pain around that area should be duly looked into and solutions provided appropriately.
Hmm.
And then for
Temidayo,
I would advise that he pays more attention because we're going to go into the substance of the disease, which is gallstone disease, and all the questions he raised will be answered.
Questions we're going to ask
and
absolutely
we'll provide that accordingly.
We still have more questions. We're going to take more of your calls, but we still do have to go on a break. We see your calls there, but we're going to take them right after the break. This is Smooth Health on the Drive, brought to you by Evercare Hospital. Our guest in the studio is Dr. Arinze Chukwu Mosanya. We're talking about
laparoscopic surgeries. Could you just help us out there?
Okay, laparoscopic surgeries with special emphasis on laparoscopic cholecystectomy for the management of gallstone diseases.
All right.
Well,
mouthful there, but we're going to go on that break and get back after this. Smooth 98.1, love music, love life. If you just joined us, you haven't missed too much, but you've missed quite a bit, though. Smooth Health is brought to you by Evercare Hospital. We've got a very special guest in the studio. Dr. Arinze Chukwu Mosanya is our very special guest today, and we're talking about laparoscopic surgeries. Now, real quick, don't forget to be a part of our conversation. You can jump in and call the number 0144-89981. That said, let's quickly jump to the next question. So we'd like to know this. What are the symptoms of gallstone diseases and also the process of diagnosis at Evercare Hospital?
Thank you. Patient with gallstone disease may have pain, like I said earlier, on the upper abdomen. They will have nausea and they will have some episodes of vomiting. And if it becomes complicated, their eyes may turn yellow, which we call jaundice, and they will pack in dark urine and have some itchiness on the body. And if it's left long-standing, it can actually transform into what we call gallbladder cancer,
okay,
which has a very poor prognosis. So at Evercare, we are a multi-specialist tertiary hospital, as you know, with offering care in a wide range of surgical and medical specialties. And we have seasoned professionals, well-trained doctors and surgeons and nurses that are experienced in providing care for these patients. So the first approach to evaluating a patient with gallstone disease at Evercare is to have an OPD consultation, that outpatient consultation, where a clinical evaluation will be done, and then proceed to do some investigations to help cone down on what the problem is. So the first step is to have what we call an abdominal ultrasound, which is performed in our radiology department,
okay,
to assess the stones and the location, the multiplicity, and then if there are any other conditions that may be as a result of complications of the gallstone disease. And in certain patients, you may have to go further to do a CT scan or an MRI to plan the patient for definitive therapy. The blood workup will assess if the patient has some of these risk factors we've mentioned earlier, such as high cholesterol, and if there's any evidence of sepsis from the blood count.
Okay.
And after that, then a treatment plan will be formulated between you and your surgeon, and we can now take it off from there on how to treat.
Now, sounds like quite the process.
All right. Now, we understand that Evercare Hospital, they are the forefront, you know, of transforming healthcare and using, you know, approaches that conform to global standards. But one of these is by using laparoscopic surgeries, right? And how is it different from open surgery?
Laparoscopic surgeries simply means using small incisions, usually not more than 3 cm if you add all of them together, and then using a camera and some special instruments and tubes to be able to look into the abdominal cavity and the pelvis, and gives the surgeon a wider view of angle and more space to work in, and perform virtually all the surgeries that you can do openly. Now, this has a lot of advantages, being that you have less scar, so it's cosmetically appealing to the patient. You have less bleeding. The healing is faster. You spend less time in the hospital, and you're able to get back to your activity as soon as possible. So these advantages are making it more appealing, definitely, than open surgery. But that doesn't mean that there are no other conditions that you may do openly. But with advance in technology and especially researches that are going on, more and more procedures are now being done laparoscopically.
Okay, so let's talk about techniques. Right? Why is this technique you mentioned more effective in managing gallstone diseases?
Because of the location of the gallbladder, which are directly under the liver, once you get into the abdomen through laparoscopic surgery, it stares at you. And it's easier and technically safer to remove it laparoscopically than making a very long and long incision on the abdomen. The long incision causes more pain for the patient and therefore keeps the patient in the hospital much longer. But using laparoscopy, patients tend to go home after about 2 or 3 days in the hospital. Infection rates are actually less in using laparoscopic surgery. And of course, it's cosmetically appealing, especially for young ladies who want to wear their clothes or go to the beach or wear bikinis.
Okay.
Having that long scar may be unappealing to them. And then laparoscopy offers them that opportunity to still have their surgery and live the life they want to live.
All right. If you're out there and you want to be a part of our conversation, don't forget 0809-444-0981 is where you can send your messages to.
Yes.
And also call us on 01-44-89-981. This one here says, hello, Smooth FM. Great job. Senior Dr. Arinze. Keep up the good work. Proud of you, sir. This is Oliveira from Festac. Maybe someone from school?
Yeah, I think so. I think I remember him, Oliveira.
All right, we'll do Thanks, have a Oliveira. Call here.
Hello.
Hello. Good evening.
Good evening. Your name, where are you calling us from?
Olushino, I'm calling you from Ilupeju.
Olushino from Ilupeju. Olushino, go ahead.
At the beginning of the doctor's interview, he mentioned bilirubin about 3 times. In lay terms, what's that and what role does he have to do in this gallstone and the rest?
All right. Thank you, Lucina.
Thank you so much, Lucina. You can call us up on 01-448-9981. Again, 01-448-9981. We have a message here from Emeka, and it goes, how does this issues affect cholesterol? Thought it's a heart problem. He thought that it was a heart problem, and now we're talking about gallstones. This one is from Chioma. She goes, question to the doctor, the pain as a symptom of gallstone issue, is it only on the right side of the abdomen? And then 2, pain on the left side is as a result of? And then 3, is there a difference between men and women in experience with gallstone issue? That's from Chioma.
Okay, let me start with Chioma. The pain on the right side for gallbladder is not the only type of pain. Patient can also have pain on the, what we call the epigastrium, just that little area just below the center of your chest.
Okay.
That people refer to as indigestion or I'm having ulcer. So if you keep on having symptoms of ulcer anytime you eat food, it may not be ulcer. It may actually be gallstone and you should have it checked out. Pain on the left side is not classical for gallstone disease. It may be a problem with your left kidney, your stomach, or even your pancreas. And if you have such things, you should please consult your doctor and have it checked out. For Emeka, yes, high cholesterol causes a wide range of problems in the body, including heart attack, predisposes somebody to stroke, and then increases the risk of having hypertension. So it's not just gallstones that high cholesterol can predispose somebody to, but it's one of the things that if you have a high cholesterol level in your body, you may be prone to developing. And for Olushino, bilirubin is a byproduct of the breakdown of red cells. So when red cells are broken down, the iron component of red cell, which gives it the red color, is combined to another substance, and which is called heme. So breaking down that heme is what leads to bilirubin, and that bilirubin is a waste product. It's secreted in bile and is now transported to the intestine where it may be passed out as 2. So when the amount of bilirubin is increased, as seen in patients with sickle cell disease, they are prone to developing what we call bilirubin stones. And that's also part of what we call gallstones. So it's not just cholesterol,
okay,
but
high bilirubin content may also predispose somebody to having stones
in the
gallbladder.
Thank you very much for that. Let's move on real quick, though. Almost out of time, but we'd like to know this. What necessitates the removal of gallstone in patients? And also, I mean, you've highlighted this before, but what is the procedure doing this at Evercare?
Well, I don't intend to make our listeners surgeons and go into details of how this procedure is done, maybe outside the scope of this program.
Okay.
But however, patients with gallstones may need to have their gallstones removed if they have recurrent pain, which we call recurrent cholecystitis, that's inflammation of the gallbladder.
Okay.
If they are having acute gallbladder infection, which we call cholecystitis, or if they start developing complications that may need to be addressed. So first of all, these patients should be admitted to the hospital and evaluated, as I mentioned earlier. And if the surgery is indicated, then that's what's called laparoscopic cholecystectomy. So they come in a day before surgery, they're evaluated by the anesthetist and are fasted overnight. In the morning of the procedure, they're taken to the theater, placed under general anesthesia, and then these incisions are made. One that is just about 1 cm at the belly button for the camera.
Okay.
And three other small incisions, about 5 millimeters each, on the upper abdomen. And through these 5 millimeter incisions, the gallbladder and the stone are removed. And after the surgery, to just be like a mosquito bite, actually. That's what we call them in the theater, that the scars are like mosquito bites. And by the evening of the surgery, patient can start taking sips of water, very liquid pulp, just to get the person accustomed to eating again.
Okay.
And by the next day, the person can actually have all the meals he or she has been having before. Usually by the third day of admission, patient should be able to go home. But the follow-up will then continue in the clinic. Of course, we'll start addressing all the other risk factors that the person has and make sure that he or she gets better thereafter. Thank you.
All right.
We have a call here. Hello.
Hello. Good evening. Hello. Good evening. Okay.
Wow.
Call back if you can.
You decided to destroy our eardrums and then not call. Anyway, call us up on 01-448-9981. Again, 01-448-9981. Send us a WhatsApp message with your questions on 0809-444-0981. We have with us Dr. Arinze Mosanya. He's from Evercare Hospital here in Lekki, and we're talking about gallstones and everything else that you need to know. Let's see who this is. Hello? Hello, good evening.
Hello, good evening.
Good evening.
Hi, good evening. What's your name?
Oh, my name is Mary. I'm calling from Lekki.
Mary from Lekki. Go ahead, Mary.
Okay, I was just wondering, what's the difference in pain between gallbladder stones and an appendicitis? And is it the same procedure to remove it? And my last question, what's the difference between local anesthetics?
Local anesthetic?
That's the right word. And the general. Can you do the local as opposed to using the general? That's my question.
All right. Thank you so much, Miriam, for your call there. Doctor.
Yeah. Thank you, Miriam. Classically, they don't present the same way. The pain of appendicitis tend to happen in the lower right abdomen. Usually, it may start like a very vague periumbilical, that's around your umbilicus pain, that now definitely shifts to the right side when it becomes severe.
Okay.
That's for acute appendicitis. However, for cholecystitis or for gallstone disease, it happens much higher up, just under your right rib cage. Although, in medicine, we say, never say never. So if you have any of such pains, I think it's best to get your doctor to check you out, to be able to tell you which one may be causing the pain, whether it's acute appendicitis or acute cholecystitis, that's gallbladder stone in the gallbladder causing inflammation. For the difference between local anesthetics and general anesthesia is that in general anesthesia, you are sleeping, you are not aware of what is happening, and you don't have pain. Mm. So those are the three things that summarize general anesthesia. While local anesthesia, you are awake, you are aware of what is happening, but you don't have pain. Classically, I think that's
you're aware of what's happening, but you don't have
pain. You're awake, you can converse with a person, you can have a discussion, person can tell you what is happening, but you don't have pain where the procedure is going on. So because of the extensive nature of the anatomy as well as the work area for laparoscopic surgeries, local anesthetic agents may not work.
Okay.
Because you are walking into the abdomen, the local anesthetic agent, the amount you need to block the whole abdomen will be a lot and it will be toxic to the individual. And because there are also things that we do, like we put a lot of gas to distend the abdomen to create the space you need to walk in, the nerves that supply the whole of the abdomen will be really stretched, and that will be difficult for the person. Person will not be comfortable at all, and it's actually not best medical practice to do that.
Final question, because we're out of time.
And also our final call here before we... Hello? Oh, we lost you there.
All right, so final question, because we're totally out of time, though. How long, I'm sure a lot of people are wondering, how long does it take a patient to heal from gallstone disease if managed with laparoscopic surgery?
The beauty of laparoscopic cholecystectomy against open is the faster recovery rate.
Okay.
And a patient that had cholecystectomy on a Monday can actually return to work the next Monday.
Just 7 days
however,
after.
However, we know that healing is a continuous process. So even if you are returning to work, we won't expect you to run a marathon or hit the gym within 1 week and all that. But doing your regular daily activities like showering, going to work, you know, walking around the house, cooking and all that, you can start that within 1 week of your surgery.
All right. Thank you so much, Doctor. I mean, this has been very, very educative and informative at the same time. If you just joined us, you've missed the entire show. We've had Dr. Arinze Mosanya. He's a minimal access surgeon. We've been talking so far about laparoscopic surgeries, managing gallstone diseases with minimal invasive surgery.
Yes, indeed.
And also, of course, we have people that have called in already. So we need to remind you to send in your details so you can claim your vouchers with Evercare. So Tami Dyer called in, Nuruddin as well, and also Richmond. It's very important that you send us your details and send them right now. Send them to 0809-444-0981. Again, 0809-444-0981.
All right, but Doctor, before I let you go, tell us how we can contact you and also Evercare Hospital.
Okay, to reach us at Evercare Hospital, we are located at number 1 Admiralty Way / Bisola Duro Simieti Drive, Lekki Peninsula Scheme 1. And our website is www.evercare.ng. And telephone number is 081-398-50710. And you can tell them to patch you on to Dr. Arinze. Thank you.
All right. Again, remember that the website is www.evercare.ng. Call them up on 081-398-50710. That's 081-398-50710. Email them on info@evercare.ng. Evercare Hospital is located at 1 Admiralty Way, Busola Durosimi Eti Drive, Lekki, Phase 1. Lagos.
All right, Lagos, there's more to come, so please stay close to your radio. In a few more minutes, something extra special we'll share with you right here at the Smooth Station.
Smooth Health on the Drive.